Hello and Tashidelik everyone. As part of TibetTV's monthly program, we are hosting researchers from Tibet Policy Institute to talk and deliberate about the research publications and articles written by them. And today I have with me Dr. Rinzin Dorjee. Dr. Rinzin Dorjee has in fact written quite a number of articles and research publications. And today I'm going to speak with him about how China uses tourism to boost economy, their economy. And in fact, Dr. Rinzin has written an article in this regard, and it is titled Tourism, that is China's money-making machine. Welcome to the program, Dr. Rinzin.
Thank you, Manjula.
First of all, Dr. Rinzin, generally speaking, when we talk about tourism, in fact, it is one of the ways a nation earns its revenue, thereby bringing economic prosperity to the people, right? But in the case of Tibet, what are the pros and cons that you see in terms of promoting tourism in Tibet?
Yes, tourism as an industry or the economic strategy for the growth of national development, it is true to say that tourism does benefit the economy of any country. But in case of Tibet, the story is different, because Tibet being under the control of the repressive control under the Chinese government, so the largely the economy of Tibet is controlled by the Beijing, that is central government, and most of the economic development policy are formulated and implemented unilaterally. That means the Beijing decide what the Tibet need, not the Tibetans ask for or required for. So this is one situation. So in case of, if you look at the situation of tourist industry in Tibet, the Chinese encourage a lot of migrant workers from the other from outside Tibet, that is Han Chinese or other.
So basically Chinese. From mainland China, right?
Yes. Okay. Because the tourist industry requires a lot of workforce to fill the gap or to do the industry service center, right? So the China has formulated different tools or strategy to encourage more and more Chinese to migrate to the Tibet based on this tourism industry. So this is the Chinese overall the tourism. So of course there are benefits to the Tibetans because of Chinese tourist development policy, because there are few number of Tibetan private or individual businessmen who opens tourist agents like Tibet Vista, which is run by Tibetans in Lhasa, and there are small restaurants and hotels run by Tibetans, and there are even taxis are driven by the Tibetans. But if you look at the larger picture, the transportations from where the Chinese migrants originate from, that is from Chinese cities, like the in Lhasa, in case of Lhasa railway stations, there are 10 different routes from the different Chinese cities where the tourist comes. So the train is run by the Chinese government. And then there are flights in the every Tibetan prefectures. So these flights are also managed by the Chinese government. So in a way, this transport income goes to Chinese government, right? If you look at the 2015, the former party secretary, schools director, who wrote and a long article on the Chinese central government investment policy written by Jin Wei. She said the Tibet Autonomous Region, which is demarcated by China as a Tibet, the only 7% of the economy of TAR is local generations. So, but the Chinese government claimed that tourism is the pillar of the Tibet Autonomous Regions, economy of the Tibet Autonomous Regions. But then out of that 7%, most of them are gone to the Chinese government or individual private business. So the true beneficiaries are not the Tibetans, I would say. So as a result of tourism department, as a result of the influx of Chinese migrant workers and the million of Chinese tourists that the Chinese government claims, the Tibetan language are under threat and the demographic shift is under threat. Because the Tibetan language as a tourism sectors required the Chinese speaking service people like the Chinese who has always the natural advantage, and then the because of tourism industry also, there are a lot of infrastructures like restaurant, hotels are coming up, and they are expropriating or taking away the lands of the local people around the cities. So which also threatens the ownership of the land by the Tibetans, because these lands are owned by Tibetans for centuries. Now, as a result of tourist industries, many of these lands are taken by the tourist industries. So lastly, if I sum up, this tourism development policy in Tibet is, to me, I find it like a policy of assimilations, that is to assimilate Tibetan people over the Chinese. Thank you.
So Dr. Rinzin, you basically talked about how China stands to gain out of promoting tourism in Tibet in terms of the economy, right? And apart from economy, what do you think is the agenda of China in terms of promoting tourism in Tibet? You talked about assimilation. I think that's one strong point.
Yes, sir. So apart from the economic gain that China has and the assimilation policy that China is trying to implement, because the China has failed to win the hearts of Tibetans through the repressive policies. Now they are using the soft power, that is tourism, right? They think that development is the only solution to the Tibet, but I think their assumption is wrong. So through this development, not only assimilations, they also narrate the Chinese communist distorted history regarding the Tibet and China relations, because they have staged different cultural performance, like Princess Wangchen's performance, and then the Sixth Dalai Lama's, His Holiness Dalai Lama, the Seiyang Gyatso performance. So these stages are used by the Chinese government as a tool, as a propaganda to brainwash the Chinese tourist, because the reality of Tibet is different, which is not shown to the Chinese tourist. And then the way the Chinese tourists roam around in the Tibet is different in the what we see in the other part of the world, because the Chinese tourists, they always book the group tourists, and they contact the Chinese run agency, and they travel in the buses that arranged by the agency, and they go to whatever the agents recommends them. So they don't see the true and real situation inside Tibet, and they see what the Chinese wanted to project to them.
They don't have the freedom to explore in their own way.
Yes, you are right. Thank you.
So, Droglala, in your article, you know, I find that most of the tourists that come to Tibet, that visit Tibet, are basically Chinese, right? In fact, you talked about this in the beginning, right? So, if this goes in the long run, let's say the Chinese tourists coming to Tibet increases over a period of time, what implication do you see in this regard in the long run?
I think the most important asset that the Tibetans have now inside Tibet is the Tibetan sense of identity and culture, the unique culture from the Tibet, which distinct us from the Chinese. So this, to preserve this language and identity, we need the language, Tibetan language, to be preserved and taught in the Tibetan schools and educational various educational institutions. And then language is also necessary as a medium of communications in these tourist service sectors. But as a result of the influx of millions of Chinese migrants moving into Tibet and settling into the Tibetan cities, especially they live in Tibetan cities, right? So as a result, the usage of Tibetan language is declining. And at the other side, the Chinese government gives freedom to use the Tibetan language in the minority law or autonomy, whatever you call it. But in reality, the medium of instruction is Chinese, as everybody knows that. And only the Tibetan is taught as a second language in Tibetan, different schools in Tibet. So as a result, in long term, if the Tibetan language is disappear from the Tibet, then the sense of identity is under threat.
Okay, Dr. Rinzila, in your article, you mentioned one very interesting thing in terms of the number of tourists that come to Tibet. According to China, you mentioned that in 2016, the number of tourists that came from China is estimated to be 20 million, while outside sources say something totally different. Like, for instance, you mentioned about the Washington Post estimate, which says that in 2016, at least at the most, there could be 3.6 million Chinese that come to Tibet. But what China projects is totally different. There seems to be a huge difference in the in these two statistics, right? So according to you, what could be the reason for the alarming difference in terms of these two statistics?
I think the when the Washington Post contacted the tourism department in China about the their statistical, so the answer they have given is that they did a miscalculation, means they have counted the tourist visit. When a Chinese tourist visit Lhasa, Shigatse, and other part of the Tibetan areas, they calculate at three times. So that's why
the same tourist is calculated,
same tourist is calculated
three times
in the different places, okay, because he has to register, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. So that's why the number has increased. Okay. So this is not the the true way of calculating the statistic of the tourists. Mm-hmm. And the second reason is those people who are in the government officials and related to the tourist development department, they want to show to the central government, to the Beijing government, that under my leadership, we have generated so much of revenue out of tourism. So much of Tibetan has given job because of tourism, and so much of tourists has arrived in Lhasa. So they want to show off their performance so that they can climb up in the leadership, the hierarchy. So I think the way the Washington Post has calculated the number of the tourists is that based on the number of trains that arrive from various cities in China to the Tibetan cities, and the number of the flight that fly from different cities in China to Tibet. So based on that, their number comes around 3.6, as you mentioned. Mm-hmm. So that article was published in 2016. So this year, 2018, the number of the train has increased, a number of flight has also increased. So I find the maximum the tourist has reached Tibet Autonomous Region, they call it Tibet Autonomous Region, comes around 9 or 10 million, not 20 or 30 at the most. But now they still claim that not only in Tibet Autonomous Region, even in Chiangmai, that is Chungmi province, they also claim that there are around 10 million has already arrived in Chiangmai province itself last year, 2017. So these are numbers are just manipulated by the Chinese local officials in Tibet.
Okay, Dr. Rinzin, in your article, in terms of studying the tourism, how it is promoted, the trends and all that, you took the case study of Gyaltang region, right? And in Gyaltang region, what are some of the research findings that you came across in your research?
Tourism in Gyaltang started with the, I think, 1933s when the British author wrote a book on the a book called The Horizon, Lost Horizon, right, sorry. So that attracted a lot of Western tourists to Tibet. And that was a period of little lenient policy by the Chinese government where the international tourists are allowed. And then in 2000, the large scale tourism started with the 2000 and 2002 because Gyaltang was designated as the real place of Shangri-La by the Chinese government. And that was induced by the Chinese central government, state council itself, during Che Talas, when he was the county's officials. Right? So one way, the Shangri-La is naturally a very beautiful place, right? And it has not only the Tibetan people, it has other non-Tibetans ethnic groups. I think according to 2010, there only 38% are Tibetans. So because of this mixed ethnic compositions of the demography and the beautiful nature of the Shangri-La, they have promoted tourism in Tibet, in Shangri-La. And then there are books which are considered to be the best-selling in China written about the Gyaltang, and there are movies, documentaries, print medias, and even the CCTV, the Chinese-run media, also promoted Shangri-La in the various Chinese cities about its beauty, and it has attracted a lot of tourism. But before the advent of tourism, the livelihood of the Gedang people were largely depend upon the wood loggings. But due to the massive wood logging in 1998, there was a major flood in Tiju River. So the Chinese government officially banned this logging. And then the Shangri-La area is also known for the vast different species of mushroom, and which is marketed internationally. And one of the most important destination is Japan. But as a result of mismanagement by the Chinese government and the local government, this business also fall down. So as a result, now the Tibetans and the local in the Shangri-La have moved their livelihood towards tourism. But that their per capita income, if you compare during the mushroom collections business and the tourism, it has a vast difference. It has just came down from around 200 to around 2,000 rupees during the mushroom collection. Now it has come to 200 and to 300 only. So the livelihood of the Tibetans and the other people living in Shangri-La has gone down.
So you're saying, although the tourism has mushroomed in parts of Gyaltang, but the Tibetans are not really the beneficiary.
Yes.
Okay, Dr. Rinzin, my final question, you know, in your article, in conclusion, you talk about how China has what we call double standard policy in terms of Tibetan language and culture. And this is actually, I think, quite an interesting claim. And my question is, how do you justify this claim, and what arguments do you have to justify this claim?
I think the Chinese is using the Tibetan culture as a tool to promote tourism. I mean the Tibetan culture, Tibetan identity, the natural beauty of Tibet are sold to the Chinese tourism. And the part of Tibetan culture is the Tibetan language, the most important characteristic. So Tibetan language is used by Chinese for their own interests whenever they find it opportunity. Like there are Chinese Tibetan language website, Tibetan media, television channels, and various video documentaries are made in Tibetan, and which narrate the Chinese version of their truth or Chinese version of history. And then in the Shangri-La itself, there is a large, huge, prayer wheel,
yeah.
Tibetan Buddhist prayer wheel, on which the outside of the prayer wheel, mm-hmm. drum, they have carved out, or you can carved out the different Chinese leaders' political propaganda thought, mm-hmm. starting from
Mao Zedong,
on the prayer wheel set outside itself. Normally, in Tibetan Buddhist practice, we used to carve only the six mantras, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Six mantra or the whatever the Tibetan goddess or gods mantras. But then the Chinese government carved out the Chinese leader thoughts on this wheel drum, right? But this is beneficial to Chinese government to promote their own narratives, right? At the other side, that is the double standard. At the other side, when the Teshi Wangjuk, who has advocated
rights, yeah.
the language right and was arrested in January 2016. So he is now charged as a splitist. So this is a double standard, I consider. At the one side, when it is beneficial to them, they use it. When someone Tibetan really talk about the rights of the Tibetan or preservation of Tibetan language, they imprison him. So I consider this is a double standard the Chinese government is doing.
Thank you, Dr. Rinzin.
Thank you so much.
With this, we come to the end of our program. And today's discussion is with Dr. Rinzin Dorjee about his article, Tourism, how it is being used as machinery to boost economy of the Chinese government. Thank you, Dr. Rinzin.
Thank you.